Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Evidence of Eternity, Communicating with Spirits for Proof of the Afterlife, by Mark Anthony, the Psychic Lawyer, narrated by Barry Abrams. Foreword. As a researcher of near-death experiences, NDEs, I never wanted to have that much to do with mediums, particularly during the early stages of my career. My work with near-death experiences and my interest in UFO experiences was outre enough for an academic like me. Besides, I was never interested in trying to prove life after death anyway, or even make a good case for survival of consciousness after physical death. I was always more interested in showing what we could learn from near-death experiences and letting my students and readers draw whatever conclusions they liked. For an academic to get too close to mediums and talk about the afterlife was to court banishment from the academy. It was stuff for the tabloids, not for the halls of Ivy. However, during my years of researching altered states of consciousness and NDEs, I learned a lot about mediums. I have no doubt that some of them can indeed transmit messages from the dead and know things about the people they are reading for that would be impossible to know by normal means. And naturally, I had read about many of the celebrated mediums of the past, Leonora Piper, Gladys Osborne Leonard, and many others. Yet, I never sought out a reading for myself until a couple of years ago, when something very peculiar happened to me that in the end I could not ignore. Ultimately, it proved to have something to do with my father. When I was very young, I was separated from my father when he went off to war during the early 1940s. Although he survived the war, for various reasons he never returned home, and then he died young, at 41, while working as an artist in New York. As I grew to manhood, I started thinking a lot about my father, and began to sense his presence in my life as a kind of guiding influence. As a scientist, my initial reaction was to question this sensation, but on some level, I felt the connection was real, so I decided to write a memoir about my father and his putative effect on my life after his death. I called it My Father Once Removed. Then, 2 years ago, I started to hear from a number of my friends, all of them independently of one another, and all of them connected in some way with NDE studies, who had recently had some kind of fantastic reading from a medium, never the same medium, mind you, and who were asking me if I had ever considered having a reading myself. Most of them exhorted me to. Of course, I demurred, declined, and generally deflected the conversation to other topics. Except, it kept happening. After the fourth such occurrence, I finally succumbed and arranged for a reading with one of the mediums who had been urged upon me by one of these friends. Afterward, I wrote an article about my reading entitled, somewhat humorously, Medium Hot, which I eventually inserted as the last chapter into a revised and expanded version of my memoir about my father. I will spare you the details, but the reading I received strongly and independently corroborated virtually everything I had learned or speculated about my father's life, which the medium could not have known by normal means. And not only that, the medium stressed my father's feelings of deep love for me, which I had previously learned from his half-sister, as well as his posthumous role in my life, which I had long sensed. Moreover, the medium was accurately able to tell me some extremely obscure facts about my family life that really blew me away. It's one thing to read about such things in books. It's quite another when it happens to you. In any case, it became apparent to me that science and mediumship are not mutually exclusive, especially when the medium focuses on evidence that can be objectively verified. This is why I have found what Mark Anthony has observed about the other side to be very instructive. His observations are based on a logical, scientific approach, rooted in evidence, and not on suppositions or jumping to conclusions. This, indeed, is one of the facets of evidence of eternity that I find impressive. Mark takes great care to demonstrate why it is important not to bring one's expectations of negativity or fear into the explorations of spirits or normally invisible entities. Of course, the unknown is often frightening, just as the night is, but his accounts of contact with spirits are very telling in this respect, as well as fascinating in their own right. Mark approaches spirit communication with integrity and professionalism. Despite his rigorous approach to his work, because he gives public demonstrations of communication with spirits, a lawyer who speaks with the dead is certainly not immune from ridicule. However, based on his sense of humor, the integrity with which he approaches his spiritual work, and most importantly, his faith in God, it seems he often has the last laugh. For my part, although I have sometimes had rewarding and stimulating encounters with true skeptics, I find debunkers masquerading as skeptics to be tedious, since they have imprisoned themselves within the walls of their own ideology. So I tend to give such people a wide berth. There are many points of resonance and consistency between Mark's work and the research on NDEs. The fascinating aspect of evidence of eternity is that messages from the other side take up the story after the NDE trail goes cold. But the two fit together like the proverbial hand and glove. Perhaps even more significant is that the spiritual implications, both for living in this world, in terms of the values by which one should live, and for the existence of an afterlife, coincide with accounts of NDE research. The big questions, of course, are what happens after death, and what is the other side like? Many who study life after death, including Mark, theorize that the other side has different levels, if one might put it that way, and that people are naturally attracted to the levels that are appropriate to them. There appears to be a consensus that there is no such thing as an archetypal hell, which is something that people who have a near-death experience would agree with. Still another point Mark's observations have in common with NDE research has to do with reincarnation. In my research, and in some other work on NDEs, I found that many NDEers became more open to the idea of reincarnation following their NDE, and quite a few of them came to believe in some form of it. Mark Anthony touches upon many sensitive issues in Evidence of Eternity, including suicide. From the standpoint of NDE research, generally speaking, my co-investigators and I found that people who attempt suicide have the same kind of initial experience as do people who have NDEs through illness or accident. They encounter the light, too, and all the love that is associated with it. Nevertheless, they understand that suicide would have solved nothing, and that they would still have to work through the same issues. Indeed, in a certain sense, it is impossible to kill yourself, because even when your body dies, you find that you are still alive. So, virtually all such people return, knowing that suicide is not the answer. It's more complicated than that, of course, but Mark's reports of individuals who have committed suicide coincide with what I have found through my NDE research. Another point of congruence between Mark's work and the findings of NDEs is that one's individuality is never lost, even when it becomes a part of something much larger. Nevertheless, one retains a sense of one's own personality when one becomes a spirit, just as Mark has observed. I have heard the same thing maintained by NDEers I have interviewed. Thus, Mark Anthony's work leads to very much the same set of implications for how to live as does the research on NDEs. Plus, it goes further than NDE studies by giving the listener a clear sense that we are never separated from our loved ones, and of what life after the death of the body is like. I also thoroughly enjoyed reading about Mark's views on animals in the afterlife, as NDEers sometimes also report encountering their deceased pets during their NDE. Then, too, the humor in this book was delightful, giving it charm as well as depth. On a more serious matter, as Mark indicates and as NDE studies show, we find that we are responsible for our actions here and will reap the consequences of them later, even after death. However, I want to make it clear that during the life review portion of an NDE, there is no judgment and no sense of punishment as such. Instead, one simply sees the effect of one's actions on those affected by them, and experiences them as if these actions also affected oneself. Thus, there is a sense of perfect justice. What one reaps, one truly does sow. One sees immediately that the golden rule is not merely a precept for moral behavior, it is the way it works. Here again there is, I believe, another point of strong resonance with evidence of eternity. Perhaps the most important parallel between Mark's work and NDE studies, however, is the conclusion that one's life is eternal. The light of divinity exists within all of us, and this realization removes the fear of the unknown regarding what happens after we die. Life does not cease to exist when the body dies. Mark's work points to the inescapable conclusion that we have a soul that is connected to a greater consciousness that continues to live in spirit form in another dimension, a realm where a higher intelligence of unconditional love exists to welcome us home when our time comes to live elsewhere. Kenneth Ring, Professor Emeritus of Psychology, University of Connecticut, author of the New York Times bestseller, Lessons from the Light. Introduction. Since the dawn of recorded history, millions of people worldwide have reported contacts with spirits of deceased loved ones. Despite the prevalence of spirit communication, many people refuse to believe in it or are skeptical of it or feel it is somehow negative. Due to the superstition and fear surrounding spirit contact, many are reluctant to admit even having such an experience. However, attitudes are changing, and today, millions of people seek connection with deceased loved ones through mediums. In my work as a psychic medium, I facilitate communication between people here in the material world and spirits of deceased loved ones. I am both an attorney and a psychic medium, and am known as Mark Anthony, the psychic lawyer. While many people tend to think of my two professions as polar opposites, they are actually both about evidence. And this book is about evidence received from the afterlife. People want to know, what happens when I die? Is there an afterlife? Does heaven exist? Does hell exist? Do animals have souls? What do messages from spirits mean? How can spirit communication help me? Is reincarnation real? Can you communicate with the spirit of someone who has already reincarnated? What if I die and my loved one has already reincarnated? Does that mean I'll never see her again, even on the other side? Other questions arise as well. Is there any science to prove this? Does the devil exist? My son committed suicide. Did he go to hell? The man who murdered my grandfather was found not guilty. If there is a God, how could God allow that? This book addresses these questions and removes the fear and superstition surrounding spirit contact. My approach is to bridge the gap between the spiritual and the scientific. In this book, I explain how science and faith are not mutually exclusive. In fact, they're often in harmony. Quantum physics, physiology, genetics, scientific theory, history, and theology are woven together in an engaging style that presents the scientific basis and theories concerning life after death, spirit communication, both human and animal, karma, reincarnation, enlightenment, and what I call enlightenment, each individual's personal connection with God. Through this logical approach, the book reaffirms for the listener that God exists, heaven exists, the soul is an immortal living spirit, communication with spirits is possible, and that we will be reunited with our deceased loved ones again once it is our time to leave this life. Yet, it goes further than other books of this genre because it takes these truths to a much deeper level and brings the reality of the afterlife and spirit contact to the listener in a new way. Evidence of Eternity explains innovative, complex, and esoteric concepts in easy-to-understand language. inspirational, gripping, edgy, and occasionally humorous true stories drive each chapter to educate, entertain, enlighten, and console the listener. Healing is a major component of this book, which tackles the tough, painful topic of the death of a loved one. This book brings life after death into the 21st century by redefining the understanding of the afterlife and the technical aspects of spirit communication. These new terms and concepts are introduced in a logical and progressive manner in order to build upon other new concepts presented in subsequent chapters. I was raised as a Catholic and even considered entering the clergy. Even though I chose a career in law, I've spent my life studying God and the religions of the world. By the term God, I am referring to a belief in a higher power. Humanity has given a host of names to this higher power, such as Supreme Being, Yahweh, Christ, Brahman, Vishnu, Buddha, Jehovah, Allah, Great Spirit, Holy Spirit, the Source, and Infinite Light. I choose to simply refer to the higher power as God. Evidence of eternity is for all people of all faiths. It is impossible to talk about life after death without discussing God and how the major world religions have viewed God, the nature of heaven or the other side, reincarnation, and communication with spirits. The ultimate objective of science may quite possibly be the discovery of God. To that end, understanding the technology behind spirituality and how to interpret the evidence transmitted to us by spirits just may be the first step. Many blessings. Mark Anthony, the Psychic Lawyer. 1. Spiritual Situational Awareness. Geronimo, the great Native American warrior, said, "We are all the children of one God. The sun, the darkness, the winds are all listening to what we have to say." But are we listening to God? God always pays attention to us. Unfortunately, we do not always pay attention to God. The messages transmitted by God and from the other side are all around us. That is, if we are listening. Situational awareness is the perception of what is happening around you in all directions at any given moment. This perception provides guidance for what course of action to take next. Situational awareness is a skill that is highly valued by police officers, firefighters, paramedics, and members of the military because it provides the ability to make snap judgments, which save lives. Spiritual situational awareness is the perception of what is happening around you spiritually. It involves being open to contact from spirits. Spiritual situational awareness is highly beneficial because it can alter the course of your life. The challenge is recognizing the contact, accepting its reality, and then trusting its guidance. I am lucky that my parents taught me about spiritual situational awareness. Both of them had psychic abilities and could perceive spirits. From a young age, I was trained to pay attention to the seen and unseen worlds around me. I have been blessed by their lessons in many ways. As an attorney, I understand the value of paying attention to details. An attorney who doesn't is one who loses cases. As a medium, my parents' wisdom taught me that spirit contact and intuition are gifts from God that must be revered and respected. In May 2001, I arrived in New York City with my niece and nephew for a family reunion. I decided to take them on a tour of the city the day before the event. It was a bright and sunny Tuesday morning. The three of us took a cab to Lower Manhattan to visit our cousin Reed, who worked in the South Tower of the World Trade Center. Reed met us in the plaza outside the Twin Towers. "Here you are, at the center of the universe," Reed exclaimed. He was excited about our visit and wanted to show us the incredible view from his office. At that moment, the World Trade Center appeared to be full of vitality, with thousands of people bustling about in every direction. However, My teenage niece and nephew were more interested in shopping for clothes than in visiting the World Financial Center. As I looked up at the spectacular twin towers glistening in the sun against a clear blue sky, I had a sudden feeling of dread, and then it happened. A flash exploded in my mind's eye. Fear and helplessness flooded my entire body. I saw an inferno of fire and smoke with enormous chunks of debris plummeting downward toward me. Consumed by a horrifying fear that I was plunging to my death, my knees began to buckle. I felt like vomiting. Covering my face with my hands, I hunched over to brace myself. "Oh my God!" I cried out loud. My niece and nephew stopped to stare at me, their mouths open. "Dude, what is your problem?" Reed asked anxiously.
I don't know," I stammered. "I saw something falling."
Within seconds, the vision subsided. I looked up again at the twin towers, only to see them gleaming magnificently skyward. "You know, Reed, if something should happen when you're up there in that building, you are trapped. I'm sorry, but I can't go up there." Reed started to express his disappointment. My nephew eyed the twin towers suspiciously.
"Leave Uncle Mark alone," my niece interjected. "You know how he is."
I felt comfort in my niece's diplomatic and sensitive understanding of my psychic abilities.
"Thanks," I whispered gratefully.
The mood of the moment lifted, and we told Reed we'd see him later at the reunion. My niece, who also never misses an opportunity to shop, quickly changed the subject.
"Hey, look, a designer outlet store. Uncle Mark, would you please take us shopping there?"
I saw Gucci in her eyes, and I was more than happy to indulge the two of them. We quickly headed away from the Twin Towers. 4 months later, on September 11, 2001, I was at my law firm in Florida preparing for a court appearance. Suddenly, one of the other attorneys flung open the door to my office and abruptly entered.
"Something insane has happened. The World Trade Center in New York is on fire."
"What?"
"Two jets just crashed into it. Both towers are burning. It's all over the news," he exclaimed.
"Good Lord," I breathed. It was all I could muster, remembering in horror what I'd seen 4 months earlier at the site.
"My God, my cousin Reed!"
Frantically, I tried to call Reed, but to no avail. I called his wife, his mother, and his sister. No one could get through to New York City. All phone lines were jammed. 2 days later, I was finally able to get through. Reed was alive. Nearly a year later, Reed visited Florida with his wife and children. He took an afternoon to come and see me at my law firm. Although he had survived the terrorist attack, I hadn't heard exactly what had happened to him. I'd heard from his wife that he had been in therapy for post-traumatic stress disorder. As he sat across the desk from me in my office, I could see he was clearly a changed man. Despite his smile, I saw deep wells of sadness in his eyes.
I wanted to talk to you about September 11th, Reed said. Somehow, I know you'll understand.
What happened? I leaned forward.
It was about 8:45 in the morning, and I was in my office. I heard this sound like nothing I'd ever heard before. It had to be an explosion. I felt the whole office rattle.
Reed's facial features tightened. Articulating his experience had to be overwhelming for him.
I left my desk and ran out into the hall. One of the secretaries screamed, "A jet just flew into the North Tower! It's on fire!"
I listened as Reed continued.
"I couldn't believe it. We all stood there watching from an office window. It was horrifying. The fire was spreading, smoke billowing, chunks of the North Tower flying everywhere. We were paralyzed with fear, not knowing what to do. My manager was on the phone with security. They told him that the Port Authority said everything should be okay, but if anyone wanted to leave, they should.
Reed paused and then said,
"It was like that movie Titanic. You know, when the ship hits the iceberg and passengers are told everything is going to be okay and somehow you know it isn't going to be okay? I thought about staying, but, well, I heard something weird," Reed explained.
"Weird? In what way?" I asked.
"For a second, I heard, in my head, I heard my Grandpa Theorin's voice, and he said, 'Go, now!'"
"You and Theorin were very close, weren't you?" I regretted never having met my great-uncle Theorin, who had died over a decade earlier. In a way, I felt I knew him, since my father had told me a lot of colorful stories about him. Reed paused.
"Doesn't that sound weird to you?"
My expression made Reed smile.
"Oh yeah, you see dead people. Supposedly, Grandpa Theorin could see them too."
"You know this ability runs in our family, Reed. So, what happened next?"
"Well, I mean, seriously, who was going to get any work done with that going on?" Reed asked rhetorically. "I was freaked out enough from the plane crash, and then I heard a ghost. I knew I had to leave."
"Okay, what then?" I asked as Reed drew a deep breath.
"It was surreal. Everyone panicked," he described. "I was the last one into the elevator, sandwiched up against the doors."
"Why in the world did you take the elevator?"
"Supposedly, we had the fastest elevators in the world. I wanted to get out of there fast," he replied, pausing before continuing. "The elevator went down a few floors and then it started shaking all over the place. People were screaming. We were getting bounced around like crazy inside the elevator."
He clenched the arms of his chair. "Was that when the second jet hit the South Tower?" I asked.
"Yeah. The doors opened, and I know this is going to sound crazy, but..."
Reed hesitated. "Go on, Reed, it's okay," I reassured him.
"When the elevator doors opened, I swear for an instant, like out of my peripheral vision, I actually saw Grandpa Theorin," Reed described. "He motioned to me. I knew I had to get out of the elevator, so I jumped out and fell on the floor. My secretary, Karen, and two other women fell next to me. The rest of the people were still in the elevator."
Reed continued.
"I was lying flat on my belly next to these women. I turned and yelled to everyone, 'Come on, get out!' But they didn't. They just stared at me."
"What happened next?" My heart was racing.
"I looked back over my shoulder and I..."
Reed tensed before answering.
"There was this sound, like another explosion, and the elevator burst into flames. Oh, Mark, I could see the eyes of some of the people who were still in it. My secretary, oh my God, she just screamed. And the elevator, it was engulfed in fire. I saw the cables that hold the elevator snap, and it fell. Everyone was screaming. It was a giant ball of fire as it fell."
Reed's whole body shook. With a trembling hand, I offered him a tissue.
"Burning embers were all over us. Karen and I rolled on the floor to put them out. It was horrible. The whole thing lasted only a few seconds.
Reed took a deep breath.
I tried to remain a calm and objective listener, but my heart was breaking for my cousin. My skills as a lawyer were being put to the test.
Then, please don't think I'm nuts, Mark. I hear what sounds like Grandpa Theron again. Now he says, get up!
You're not nuts, Reed. Please go on. I was on the edge of my seat.
I got up and helped Karen and these two other ladies. I don't even know who they were. And we ran to the stairs. I must have been in shock. I felt my body going through the motions. It was like I was there, but not there. The stairs were packed with people. The strange thing was, even though we were all in a state of panic, no one was shoving or pushing.
And people say New Yorkers are rude, I said, trying to use some humor to diffuse the tension.
I got to the lobby. It was unbelievable. The arched windows were shattered. Marble walls cracked. Elevators had crashed. Artwork and statues were smashed. It was horrible, he continued. Finally, I got outside.
Reed paused.
Everything was out of control. People were running and screaming. Firemen and cops were all over the place. Karen got separated from me in the crowd. She just disappeared. And then I heard...
Reed stopped and drew a deep breath. What did you hear, Reed?
I started to run to the right, but I saw, I felt pulled to the left. And just for an instant, I saw Grandpa Theron. So I turned to the left, and as I moved, something hit the ground right next to me. It missed me by a few feet, and it splattered all over me. And, oh, the sound it made when it hit the ground. A thud,
Reed said, tears streaming from his eyes. What almost hit you, Reed? What did you hear? I asked in rapid succession.
I heard a thud, he said, trembling.
A thud, I responded, not fully comprehending what he meant.
A thud, Mark, a thud, he repeated. It was a body hitting the ground. It was a man's body. He hit the ground just feet from me. Stuff splattered all over me.
Reed began to sob.
Every time I close my eyes and try to sleep, I hear that sound, that thud.
I felt tears in my eyes.
If it hadn't been for Grandpa Theron, he would have landed on top of me, he sobbed.
Horrified, I recalled the images from television of those who were trapped above where the jets hit the Twin Towers. Many jumped to their deaths rather than be burned up in the fire. Reed's experience made this all too real.
I panicked. I thought I was going to puke, Reed exclaimed.
The details of my premonition became hauntingly familiar.
I ran and got caught up in the crowd. I fell and started getting trampled. I thought, now I'm going to die, Reed recalled.
He shook, struggling to maintain self-control.
But then I heard him again, Grandpa Theron, shouting but not shouting. It was in my head, and he said, get up, boy, you gotta live.
I listened, transfixed.
But I couldn't get up. People were stepping on me, trampling me, Reed described, fighting tears. Then this fireman, this young Latino guy, pulled me to my feet and asked if I was okay. I saw such fear in his eyes, Reed said.
His own eyes closed. He rescued you, I suggested gently.
Yeah, he did. And I don't even know how he saw me in the crowd. I've never respected anyone more in my life. Not because he saved me, but because this guy was scared to death too, and he was doing his job, caring more about other people than his own life.
We sat in silence as Reed regained his composure.
Mark, you have to believe me. If it weren't for my grandfather's spirit, I wouldn't be here. It's like he reached out from heaven, telling me to leave, to get out of the elevator, which direction to run. I even think he sent that young fireman to save me. I'm so grateful, but at the same time, so full of guilt that I'm alive.
Survivor guilt.
That's what my shrink says, Mark.
Reed's hands shook as he reached into his pocket and pulled out a pack of cigarettes and a lighter. I'd never known him to smoke before. The law firm doesn't allow smoking in the office, I said hesitantly.
I need it to calm my nerves, Reed responded, lighting a cigarette.
You shouldn't smoke, Reed. It isn't good for you.
Oh, like it's going to kill me?
He asked through a cloud of smoke.
Well, it's a bad habit, I offered lamely.
Reed took a puff, smiled slightly, and retorted,
Smoking doesn't send you to hell. It just makes you smell like you've been there.
His slight smile faded.
And I've been there.
The magnitude of spirit contact is immense. Contact from the other side is beneficial in many ways. For Reed, spiritual situational awareness saved his life. For my friend Emma, this awareness brought her peace and clarity at the end of her life. Emma was an elderly woman living in South Africa. She heard about my work as a medium and my views on the everlasting nature of life during an interview on a worldwide radio broadcast. This prompted her to send me an email. I opened her email, and something, or rather someone in spirit, gave me the impression I needed to speak with her. I answered, indicating I'd welcome the opportunity to talk to her. The next day, I received another email with instructions on how and when to contact her on a face-to-face internet link. When the link was established and her image appeared on the screen, I was stunned. Emma was lying in a hospital bed, propped up so she could see the computer screen and talk to the camera. She appeared extremely thin and very frail. I was surprised someone so ill had gone to such lengths to arrange a session with me. A young South African man in a crisp white medical uniform stood next to her. "I'll be over here, ma'am, if you need anything," he told Emma before stepping out of the computer camera's view.
"This computer thing, it's really quite amazing, isn't it?"
She smiled into the camera. "Yes, yes, it certainly is," I responded.
"I've got cancer. They tell me I haven't long to live."
Emma's blue eyes sparkled as if in defiance of the cancer that was consuming her.
"I'm very much at peace about going home. I've never feared death. I feel a sense of completion and that it is just my time."
I was humbled by her courage in the face of impending death and wanted to help her in any way I could. Although I know that death is merely a transition, it is still frightening to most people. Yet somehow, this Emma, this ray of light, seemed so unafraid.
"I feel spirits are around me. If you can, Mark, I would like to know who they are."
Emma requested. Would you mind if we start our session with a prayer? As I believe prayer raises vibrational frequency, I asked. When she nodded, I closed my eyes and prayed to God for guidance. Then I felt the connection with the other side. When I had finished, I saw Emma gazing intently at me through the internet link, so I began. I see three women coming forward. Two are on the parent level, and one is on the grandparent level. All are connected to you through your mother's side of the family. Emma listened quietly. Their relationship to you is very close. They feel like a mother, an aunt, and a grandmother. Your mother, or the woman who feels like your mother, has very light-colored hair, white hair, and very bright blue eyes. I see tremendous warmth in those eyes, I described. Emma nodded. Please, go on. One of the things I sense about your mother is the expression in her hands. Her hands are so soft and warm. I feel her reaching out in gentleness and taking your hand in hers. She says, you get your strength from her. Mother had such lovely hands, and yes, they were very warm and soft, Emma confirmed. Your aunt is a thin woman. She wore glasses, and her hair was more gray than white. She was a quiet person who internalized her feelings and never spoke out when she felt that she had been treated poorly. Her inner quiet made her strong, but it was also her weakness. She never allowed anyone to know how much she suffered emotionally. In many ways, she epitomizes the expression long-suffering, I conveyed. Aunt Justine, Emma sighed, such an unhappy woman. Her message to you is that the other side is free of suffering, and all the pain you go through in the material world is but a gateway to a joyous life on the other side. At least it was for her. That is what she wanted me to tell you. What about my grandmother? Emma asked. Your grandmother's energy is quite different. She seems to be describing herself as quite the taskmaster with her children. Emma nodded and tried to say something, but she began to cough. Your grandmother was not cruel, but she was a stern disciplinarian. She wanted her daughters to have more than she had and pushed them to be the best they could. Her forceful personality dwarfed your aunt, but not your mother. Your mother knew how to get around her strong character. You've captured their personalities, Emma said, struggling to suppress another cough. What messages do they have for me? They act as a unit of three on the other side. They're at peace with one another, and it feels as if they've been nurses to you in your pain and suffering. All of them want you to be spared this cup of pain, but they also know that your journey isn't about to end. Rather, it is to begin anew. They want you to understand this, to always focus on the light, and to never be afraid. From the peace they project, they are in the heaven dimension of the other side. As Emma's coughing intensified, the male attendant came into the camera's view. He reached toward the computer keyboard and said gently, "That's enough for today, Miss Emma." My computer screen went dark. A few days later, I received this email from Emma. "Hello, dear Mark. I know you are worried about me. Do stop. I've had a good life. I want to thank you for the reading. The information was very accurate. I am so grateful. Thank you. It is so comforting to know they will be there when I cross over, and that they have been there helping me all along. Heaven sounds so lovely. I think we learn much through suffering. It deepens us and makes us more compassionate to the suffering of others. Somehow, I feel I was meant to experience this cancer, and that is okay. I am feeling very tired lately, but I'm getting things in order. I have a lot of heat in my body, which gets very intense at times, and this is very draining. I am trying to be strong and asking God and His angels to not let it be too long. I look forward to being out of my body and free. God bless you, Emma. We continued to email each other for a few months. As Emma's emails became shorter and shorter, they seemed like a metaphor for the life force draining from within her. Eventually, the emails stopped altogether. One morning, I was in my office and thought about contacting the nursing home. Since I was not a family member, I knew they would not divulge any information. It was at that moment that I felt the nearness of a gentle and loving presence. It was Emma. She had passed away and gone to the other side. It made me sad to have lost someone I'd come to know as a friend, and at the same time, I was happy because her suffering was at an end. I had been privileged to touch the heart of this brave woman who had approached her death with total clarity and serenity. Spiritual situational awareness has many benefits. It can be quite intense, or it may be very subtle, but it is always powerful. While the messages were very different for Reed and Emma, paying attention to the other side proved to be, for them, gifts from God. Two. Inheriting the double-edged sword of psychic ability. Gifts from God come in many ways, and sometimes they appear in the form of inherited abilities. Science is only beginning to unlock the intricate nature of genetics. Many traits, such as health conditions, athletic prowess, and intelligence, appear to have a basis in heredity. While everyone has the same basic physiology, genetics account for the fact that each of us has different mental or physical capabilities. Studies conducted at UCLA.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.